You are listening to the Hiking Radio Network, where we talk the walk with shows by hikers about hikers for everybody.
Welcome to the Trail Dames Podcast, where we speak with women who love to dance upon this earth. Hey everyone, welcome back to the Trail Dames Podcast. If you've been listening for a while, I hope you've been enjoying my Appalachian Trail journal entries. I've been sharing with you tales of my own attempt at a through hike. Well, you might remember I mentioned several times my awesome friend, Jan Leitschuh. Leitschuh was a horse whisperer who one day got bitten by the AT bug, and she hiked the same year I did. And while she was doing her hike, she kept an extraordinary journal. She never published that journal, but she gave me permission to share it with you here on the Trail Dames Podcast. The stories will come back in the future, but now for the next few months, I want you to take a trip on the AT with Leitschuh. She experiences every second of her hike with depth and with wonder, and she shares it beautifully. I know you're gonna love it. My name is Anna. All my friends call me Mudbutt, and today I'm introducing you to my friend Leitschuh. Thanks for listening to the Trail Dames Podcast. I'm gonna dance upon this earth. March 2nd. Day 2, Hawk Mountain Shelter to Gooch Gap. Happy was leaving the trail to go home. He came out to spend a few days in the woods, to meet a few hikers, and to follow journal-wise. He gave me the last few ounces of his fuel, as the seal on my heat bottle was allowing evaporation. I'm going back to the Sprite bottle. I'm carrying the same alcohol stove that I did on the long trail, and so far, it is performing well. What I'm really failing in, however, is stove lighting. My cold fingers just can't get the thing working. I may have to go back to matches. As I was shouldering my pack to leave the shelter, in walked two familiar faces from the long trail, Mama Lipton and Flatlander. We hugged and they said another LT hiker friend, Pilgrim, had shuttled them. Pilgrim is my ride back to Neil's Gap on March 9th. I have to get off the trail on business for 5 days. Dog, Winch, and I hike together again today. They will go on when I get off at Neil's Gap, so I am enjoying their company while I can. We made many Ted jokes today, which I took as a healthy sign. Ted truly felt like a companion, and every time someone ripped off a raunchy zinger, we blamed Ted for it. So far, Ted has been very bad this trip. We also observed the various uses to which we had put our Ted tea towels. After all, this is backpacking, so everything must have a dual purpose. Let's see. There were Teddy tent wipes, Teddy face rags, Teddy body wipes, Teddy head bandanas, Teddy Kleenex, Teddy sit pads. There are about 18 Teddy towels out in circulation on the trail. During the day, we tie a Ted to the back of our backpacks, so Teddy sees all. Dog ripped off a particularly loud bit of flatulence. We are eating some strange and indigestible foods. And he immediately exclaimed, Ted! I shot back, was that your Ted or my Ted? Yes, this is what it has come to, sad to say, adults laughing at fart jokes. Sassafras was still sassafras, steep and wearying. We plodded up. What else to do but plod up? Go home? We had lunched at Horse Gap. Dog took my picture by the sign, lest I forget how to spell horse. My new camera is persnickety. Perhaps I should read this heavy manual I'm carrying. The climb up Sassafras after lunch whooped me, and I was dragging. Caught up with the crew at Justice Creek, and we expected the long climb of 2 years ago. Was there a reload? It wasn't as hard as I remembered. We got to the new Gooch Gap shelter and were still cooking. My friend Hopeful's sister designed this one, and it was sweet. It even had a moldering privy of the type I had seen in Vermont. This one smelled like cedar chips.
It works via aerobic decomposition. We three decided to march on. Bearcat was still a day ahead of us. He said he needed time to be alone after learning about Ted. Any miles we did today shortened tomorrow's 12 miles. A bit much for this old bod so early in North Georgia. 2 more miles took us to Gooch Gap. 2 miles just doesn't sound like much unless you've backpacked in the mountains. But it means an hour of hard labor this time at the end of the day. I didn't have my groove yet out here. No blisters, but lots of arch, calf, and hip pain as unused muscles groaned back into service. I knew the groove would come. I just needed to be patient. About 10 minutes away from the gap, a hiker appeared coming toward us. It was Bet, a.k.a. Swallowtail. She was still out, plying the gaps with her trail magic. She brought me a light neoprene wrap for the small of my back, gave water and 2 tent stakes that I had forgotten in the madness of the week before. We used her van as a bear bag that night. Maybe 20 tents out in Gooch Gap. Bumpkin and Kevin, who is now called Sniper, stayed in the old shelter, which still exists, though the book says it doesn't. A young hiker named Diesel sported a huge bloody blister on his heel. Duct tape was not helping. Second skin wasn't sticking. I offered up my secret weapon, Compede. Don't leave home without it. I doctored his foot, and in return, he cracked out his guitar and serenaded us past dark around a campfire. Dog and Swallowtail had stoked. Diesel's hiking friends Beck joined in with her fabulous voice and presence. They sang gospel songs. The music and heat attracted nearby campers, and soon we had 3-part harmony. Ted would have loved it. It was beautiful. One haunting song went, "Open the eyes of my heart, I want to know." I had to leave the fire. It was so evocative of Ted that it started me sobbing. I couldn't catch my breath. I walked off until the thing had run its course, blew my nose on my teddy tent wipe, and went back and sat with Winch, who was resting on a log a little ways back. "I hear you, sister," she said in a thick voice. That song had struck her the same, too. The wind just roared through the gap. It sounded like the trees might fall. The mist was blowing out and a front was coming through. Jan Leitschuh, AT class of 03. Day 3, March 3rd, Gooch Gap to Woods Hole Shelter. The roaring wind made for an uneasy sleep as the nomad tent snapped and shook. I hate to curse myself, but no blisters so far. I'm wearing my old Montrails from the long trail, though, so I know I will have to replace them soon. The rocks of Vermont tore them up. Unfortunately, every pair of shoes I've since purchased, including identical pair of Montrails, has rubbed me raw somewhere. Perhaps the outfitter at Neil's Gap can get the fit right for my funny feet. Though I was wiping condensation when I woke up at 3 a.m., by 6 it was snowing inside the tent as the drips froze. Temperatures are dropping. Dog woke up and announced that it was 19 degrees. There was ice sludge in my water bottle as I poured out a measure to make my morning oatmeal. I had gotten up first and fetched the food bags from Swallowtail's van, dropping them in front of Winch and Dog's tent, breakfast in bed, and I returned to my warm bag. I was the hypothermia princess this morning, the last one to exit the warm bag. We hit the trail flying and warmed up eventually. We make good time on the 3.6 miles to Woody Gap. Coming down the hill, I saw a familiar face and voice, but had a moment of dislocation. Why, it was my friend Anna, with whom I hiked last November around Irwin. She drove up from Atlanta to find us and had a table full of generous trail magic, Oreos, moon pies, because you know this is the South, Butterfingers, cookies, and miracle of miracles, Snickers. Dog also snagged a sausage biscuit from McDonald's, and bless his hungry heart, he shared it with me, Winch, and A-Train. Good dog. And chairs! What a luxury to lean back. Anna had also slacked Bearcat, we learned, who has dislocated a toe. He has gone on to Neil's Gap to find a doctor. Swallowtail was also there with water, van support, and boiling hot chocolate in cups. She even gave Sniper a spoon to replace his lost one. We felt like a celebrity again with everyone snapping our pictures and hugging us. Anna will also begin her thru hike on March 19th. After a sunny hour of lollygagging and socializing, we hit the trail again. Of course, it went straight up. By now, we had all stiffened up again. The sharp slope of Big Cedar snapped us back to reality. So long, celebrity. Hello, slogging. Lots of leg burnings up and down today as our adventure began to catch up with us. We crested to Parsons Rock, a large bare slab with the fine Georgia mountains stretching out behind. There are probably 8 of us up there. We all stood on the rock and had a big camera handoff. We joked about everybody having the same pictures in their journal. Pack 31 leapfrogged each other all day. I'll miss this crowd, but alas, they must go on as I get off for 5 days. For once, the sun was out, though the wind was sharp and cold. It became a hat-on, hat-off sort of day. Towards the end of the workday, we started dragging, but were convinced that Woods Hole Shelter was just a half mile further. Anyone can go half a mile. Imagine our woe when a ridge runner informed us that the shelter was another mile and a half down the trail. We groaned and decided that this was a true test of trail grit. We made it, and I was lucky to have a spot in the new shelter. The privy here leaned backwards, very weird, but it had a fantastic view of the sunset to the west. Mother Nature graced us with the first glorious sunset of the trek, all orange and rose. It made the land glow red. People were running down to the privy to snap a picture from there, which could put a kink in a shy bladder. Jolly supper around the picnic table. Cold tonight. I slept between a New Zealand girl named Braveheart and Jenny Buddenberg, who was experimenting with dimples as a trail name. Miracle of miracles, nobody snored, not even young A-Train. Jan Leitschuh, AT class of 03. And Mudbutt here, just a couple of notes for you. So from here on out, LiteShoe and I were both on the AT. My journal entries, I started reading at the very, very beginning of the Trail Dames podcast. So when you go back to the beginning and listen to the interviews, you can follow my tales as I went down the trail. Also, that beautiful view that they took pictures at, that's actually Preacher's Rock. And if you get a chance, go hike it. It's really beautiful. Now, go hit the trail. See what I mean? Isn't her writing fantastic? Like I mentioned, she hasn't published these journal entries, and I just really appreciate her sharing them with us. But you know what she has done? Before she did her AT through hike, she did a through hike of the Vermont Long Trail, and she did write a book about that. It's called The Ordinary Adventurer, Hiking Vermont's Long Trail, a Primer for Baby Adventurers and Other Musings on the Nature of the Journey. You can find it on Amazon. I have put the link in the show notes, and I hope that you will go and order it because it is wonderful. I want to say a quick thank you to Steve, aka Mighty Blue. He is our fantastic producer. He is also the creator of the Hiking Radio Network. If you're enjoying the Trail Dames podcast, definitely go check out the network. All the podcasts there are wonderful. And if you are enjoying our podcast, do me a favor. Share it with your friends and family. Share it on your social media. We want to get the word out about the Trail Dames podcast so we can help inspire women to get out and hike, hike, hike. My name is Anna. All my friends call me Mudbutt, and I really appreciate you listening. Now go hit the trail.
I have always been a dreamer since I was a little girl. Someone's always trying to change me. Well, that can't happen now. Suffer.